which is the National Education Policy 2020. And what is distinguishing about this particular policy is that it is the first policy of the 21st century. But even as I say that, the 21st century, I think we all need to recognize the fact that we are already 20 years into this particular millennium, and this, we have already covered about 1/5 of this particular millennium. Now, the philosophical foundations that form the basis of the recommendations of the National Education Policy 2020 stem from the fact that many of you may be already aware that there was a UNESCO report that was brought out in 1996, Learning in the 21st Century, Learning the Treasure Within. What was significant about this report, and I'm not referring to many other aspects of it, but the aspect that learning is not a unidimensional activity, that learning is a multidimensional activity, and it significantly identified four different areas that learning connects itself to. And that happens for any one of us in our journey of the learning process. It also needs to be recognized, and I'm sure the Sustainable Development Goals of 2030 have clearly outlined that, that we are living at a time when lifelong learning is a reality. And the fact that you are actually in an open university system, it is actually sort of doubly making it strong that you need to have a gradation of knowledge and make yourself lifelong learners. So the learning four pillars that has been outlined in the UNESCO report is learning to know, which is the knowledge aspect of it. The second is the learning to do, which is the application of the knowledge or the activities related to that learning, which is the skill aspect of it. If you were to relate it to your three domains of learning, it is the psychomotor part of it. The application and the practical aspects relating to the acquisition of that knowledge, so the skill part of it. The third is learning to live together and to live with others, the importance of coexistence and tolerance, and to be able to actually live in a sustainable, peaceful manner together. And finally, learning to be, which is the self-actualization of one's potentials and one's talents. Every single human being brought into this world by the Creator is unique in terms of their aspirations and their abilities and their potentials. And it is therefore the learning four aspects, learning to know, learning to do, learning to live together and to live with others, and learning to be, that makes an education system very, very critical to actually empower students and all sections of the society, particularly those who are learning and in the aspect of lifelong learning, to have the knowledge, the aptitudes, the attitudes or the capabilities and the skills. So if I were to put it, it is the knowledge, abilities and the skills or the capabilities that arise out of those skills. You normally refer to it as the KAC syndrome related to the four pillars of learning. And to top it all up with the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, the SDG 4 talks about equitable and quality inclusive education for all with lifelong learning opportunities. In this context, the NEP 2020 has been a comprehensive effort to look at all sectors of education, starting from the preschool stage at the age 3, going on to cover the entire school sector, then into the higher education, which embodies and embeds within itself the technical and the professional education, as well as vocational education, teacher education, adult education, and within it, the aspect of open and distance learning, technology in education, and aspects relating to internationalization and so on. So the policy has recognized that these sectors are not watertight compartments. They're highly interconnected, and that there are synergies that take place or impacts that take place at each level of learning, which affects a learner's trajectory of learning or a learner's progression as he or she moves into the higher levels of learning. So it's very critical for those who are trying to understand the NEP 2020, not just because we are in higher education space, and I'd like to focus largely on higher education because it's about 250 now, And I would like to really end the session by about 3:30, which would be a substantial time for you to, if at all, want any interaction on the NEP. But I would just make you all be sensitive to the fact that if you're reading the 66-page document, which is the NEP 2020, it is to be read in the context of understanding the basic recommendations that affect even early childcare and education. And IGNU has a course itself for diploma in early childhood care and education. And then to understand the recommendations of the school education, where we are talking about a new structure of the 5+3+3+4, and then go on to understanding how the idea of flexible learning formats have then translated itself into the higher education to talk about the holistic multidisciplinary education. So I urge each one of you to take your time out as, let us say, enlightened citizens of this country, to be able to understand that the policy has tried to base itself on the aspect of flexibility, because that is the most critical thing. See, there are three or four important things that you need to contextualize to understand why this policy is there. As I said, it is the 21st century policy, and therefore we want our students to be empowered with what we call the 21st century skills. And we are living at a time when India happens to have one of the youngest populations in the world, a window of opportunity that we see up to 2029, and therefore that we would like to leverage the demographic dividend, so to say, and you can leverage a demographic situation only if the youth are empowered with the right kind of knowledge, abilities, and capabilities, and the skills. If you do not have that, you are likely to see or stare at a future which is like a demographic disaster. And the third most important thing, which is contextualized to this particular conversation that we are having today, is that we are living in 2020, which happens to be what India had declared in 2010 in the Indian Science Congress as the decade of innovation. And this being a talk under the innovation cell activities, which are innovations in distance education. So you need to actually understand that any education policy is a response to the changing requirements and the changing needs. And it tries to actually try to equip teachers, students, educational institutions to meet with the challenges of the 21st century. This is what we are living in currently. And this particular policy, which has come out after 34 years, is likely to remain in force for another 30 to 40 years, which means even up to the middle of this particular century, it is going to be the NEP 2020 that would be the way forward. And the policy itself is merely an aspirational document. You must understand, it is not a legal document. Policies are visionary documents, aspirational documents, and you cannot take it to a court of law. But if a policy is not implemented, then the envisioned reforms do not take off on ground. Now, in school education, in this particular policy, the chapter one, which is the introductory chapter, has identified 5 goals of this policy, and which many of you are familiar with. It is of access, equity, quality, affordability, and accountability. And based on these 5 goals, we have outlined 22 cardinal principles, which are listed out in the introductory chapter, which makes sense to those who are trying to understand the recommendations. These principles stem, as I said, from the first point that we are recognizing the unique potentials of every single child, and that each child has to be nurtured in optimizing and maximizing that potential, which is a reflection of his or her aspiration. And if you want that kind of an education system, then we need to move away from the current system of education, which is highly structured, which is not flexible, which does not allow me the options to choose subjects ranging from sciences to arts to maybe performing arts to sports and so on. So in order to therefore understand the aspects of this policy, we need to recognize that learning itself, or rather knowledge itself, is a very multidimensional aspect. And therefore, silo-based learning that we currently have of typifying that something is art, science, commerce, and allowing students to specialize only in these areas of specializations would really be disastrous, because in the coming times, there are two or three things which are realities. One is the onslaught of technology. And by onslaught of technology, I'm trying to tell you that artificial intelligence, big data, machine learning, Internet of Things, augmented reality, these are going to take over the jobs that many human beings were doing. And because of this kind of technological interventions, we are not even able to predict what are the jobs of tomorrow. If we are not able to predict what are the jobs of tomorrow, then what are you going to equip your students if you are going to just dole out degrees which are of art, science, commerce, engineering, medicine, agriculture, pharmacy, law, and all silo-based, narrow discipline-based knowledge? That cannot serve any purpose, because we accept the porosity of knowledge and therefore the need for interdisciplinarity and multidisciplinary education. And that is why the major change in higher education is to break away from discipline-specific degrees to having multidisciplinary degrees. And this whole transformation is one of the most difficult ones to implement, but we would be able to do that because all higher education institutions are autonomous bodies and will need to move towards a new multidisciplinary degree granting system. And therefore, the undergraduate program is where, and I would like to focus in this discussion because within the limited time, I don't think we would be able to really talk in detail of all the NEP recommendations, but largely focus upon the new format of the undergraduate and the postgraduate education and the optimal learning environments, including teacher education, because we have courses in teacher education in IGNO, as well as vocational education. Now, the four-year undergraduate program, we will be calling it as a four-year multidisciplinary education, where a student would have the option of taking up, let us say, two subjects or two courses in economics, maybe two courses of engineering, maybe two courses of music, maybe a course even in law, or maybe a course even in a particular sport. Now, this flexibility, where you are totally making it very unstructured and you're decluttering the kind of discipline-based knowledge that you're currently having, along with equipping the students with the right kind of 21st century skills of collaborative learning, of critical thinking, of cognitive thinking, of the power to sort of examine and analyze and apply that knowledge, and therefore be able to actually apply the theoretical knowledge gained into real life situations with a high degree of adaptability, will equip the students for the uncertainties that we are going to witness in the job market arising from the technological changes. The reason, therefore, of having a very flexible undergraduate program, which many would say at the current stage, if you're looking at the current scenario, looks like a dream, looks like a vision, which is not translatable on ground. The policy has clearly articulated that current HEIs, whether they are IITs, whether they are state universities, whether they are open universities, whether they are centrally funded universities, any of these patterns that they have, may not be able to offer all these choices to the students. And therefore, we are saying that we will allow students to choose courses, not necessarily from the institution he or she has taken admission to, but from a number of other institutions which may be in the same geographical vicinity in what we call an HEI cluster. Or alternatively, the person may choose to take admission, let us say, since we are in Cochin, in Rajagiri College, but then will take up courses which may be there in management from another institute, or maybe choose a course from IGNO to do it under the open and distance learning, or maybe do it as a MOOCs course available on the SWAYAM platform. So the flexibility is not just in the courses, it is also in the mode of learning. It need not necessarily be an undergraduate program where the student is acquiring all the credits of that particular discipline or that particular, of that particular undergraduate program only through a face-to-face mode, but it can be through open and distance learning, and it can be through MOOCs also. Now, you would ask a question, how is this ever going to be possible? Because what is going to happen is that if there are 100 students in a particular college, 100 students' undergraduate courses will be very, very distinct, customized, and not at all identical, because you're going to have students taking a variety of combinations and in a variety of modes. That is possible because we have recommended that there will be an academic bank of credit, where just as you have a bank account and you have money being credited into it from different sources, in the same way, an academic bank of credit will allow for students to keep accumulating the academic credits acquired through multiple institutions or through multiple modes of learning, and the final degree would be given depending upon one or two major subjects into which that student has tried to specialize in. And this whole program is can be completed within a maximum period of 4 years. So your current structure of an undergraduate program being 3 years would change, where we are allowing for a 3 year or a 4 year undergraduate program, and where a student at every year is entitled to get a kind of a completion certificate. So at the end of first year, the student is entitled to a certificate, at the end of the second year, a diploma, the third year, a normal bachelor's degree, and the fourth year, a bachelor's in multidisciplinary education. And if in the fourth year, the student has even done a research, then the student would be having a bachelor's degree with research, entitling him or her to do a PhD degree directly without doing a master's program. But where a student has done a 3 years bachelor's, the person would do a 2 years of master's and then go on to do the PhD, whereas the other would be doing only a 4 year student without a research project will do a 1 year of master's and then go on to do the PhD. So you see the whole combinations that we are giving to you. The whole thing has been made so flexible, which is modular with exit and entry. And so the idea of lifelong learning, suppose a student does a 1 year certificate, which is already there in the open system, it is already there to some extent, but it is not there in the regular system of education, where a student would do a first year and have the option to re-enter after a break. Now, when we formulate the guidelines, when we actually bring out the implementation guidelines, we will have to specify how many years. Can I take a course in 2020 if there is an availability of the four-year program and then decide to come back in 2030? Can our higher education institutions operate with that wide window? It's quite difficult for us to implement. So we may say that suppose the four-year multidisciplinary education is becoming effective, let us assume from an academic year of 23-24, then we may say that the student who is joining in 23-24 academic year may take a break after 24 and come back in 2026 or 2027. So maybe we will allow up to 5 years. Now that will all be fine-tuned and detailed when we make out the implementation guidelines. At the moment, I would like you to understand that the undergraduate program allows for flexibility in the choice of courses, allows for flexibility in the number of institutions through an HEI cluster, in the modes of learning, acquires credits which can be pooled into an academic bank of credit. And how do you establish the equivalence of the courses from one institution to another? We will have a national higher education qualifications framework, where suppose a student is doing a vocational course, then you will have the NHEQF outlining that a skill-based course, you let us assume that the student has done something is a skill-based course in plumbing. Depending upon the level, whether it would be called a first-year level of plumbing or a second-year level of plumbing or a third-year level of plumbing. So the National Higher Education Qualifications Framework, along with the academic bank of credit, and allowing this flexibility in the number of years of duration, will automatically bring about changes in the content of the master's level course as well as in the eligibility to join the PhD program. It would be relevant at this stage to tell you that the MPhil degree has been by the NEP recommended for discontinuation. And many are asking us this question, why did we want to discontinue MPhil? Now, why was MPhil ever there as a course? It was either an admission, it was either an eligibility to for admission to the PhD, or it was an eligibility to become a lecturer, which is today called an assistant professor. Now, both these is no longer requiring MPhil. You don't require an MPhil. It is not a mandatory eligibility to join a PhD program. Neither is MPhil an eligibility to become an assistant professor. When a qualification is redundant, it is obsolete, it no longer serves either an academic or an employment purpose. There is no point in continuing with a program which actually would be a waste of time for the student. But when we say it is discontinued, please understand the policy was approved on 29 July 2020. It does not mean that the MPhil degree stands discontinued on 29 July. You will have the UGC or the Higher Education Commission of India, whichever is the regulator, bringing out a proper notification. And when they bring out that notification also, due care will be taken to understand how many students are pursuing MPhil across the different universities in this country. When are their maximum durations getting over? And first they would stop the admissions to the MPhil and then only discontinue with the ongoing MPhil courses that are going on. Coming to the aspect of students, which is what this particular audience is largely about, the policy has recognized that this is an education policy and the main stakeholder are students, teachers and educational institutions. It could be schools or universities or colleges. Students of today have much different aspirations what other than students like us. As each generation of students are moving on, our children, our grandchildren will have different aspirations, not the ones that we had. And therefore, the students of today are those who are very different in terms of not only their aspirations, they're living at a time where technology seems to be like a second skin to them, where they are able to handle technology so effortlessly. At the same time, India being a very diverse country, students come from different cross sections of the society. Being a very pluralistic country, they speak different languages, they belong to different social groups, they come from different castes and communities, they come from urban or rural areas, their gender matters, they could be transgenders, they could be migrant laborers, people living in geographically inaccessible areas. So for the aspect of equity, we have devoted two chapters, chapter 6 and chapter 14. And we have referred to a terminology, a new term, socially and economically disadvantaged groups or SEDGs, to address the educational needs of these sections of the population. And how do we define socially and educational? Any category of people whose educational participation, which is normally measured in higher education by their gross enrollment ratio in the age group of 18 to 23, that population of students being in the higher education, and if it is less than the national average, the current national average is 26.3. So if you say SCs, STs, OBCs, minorities, women, transgenders, people living in tribal areas, children with disabilities, both learning and physical disabilities, migrant children, people coming from, let us say, absolutely backward areas, urban poor, all these categories are whom we have called in the policy as the socially and economically disadvantaged groups. And for them, we have recommended special interventions in terms of actually providing enhanced scholarships, creating special education zones, creating a gender inclusion fund, creating a social inclusion fund, setting up more hostels and reading rooms for them. And most importantly, we have said in higher education for the first time that the medium of instruction need not necessarily be English. Now, this is a real radical reform that we are looking at, because many in the, India is an agrarian country, let us understand that. 80% of the Indian population depend upon agriculture. And we are blessed with the fact that we have an agrarian economy. There are people who are living in agriculture-based economies, and like in our country also, who don't take up higher education because it is very daunting to think of an education system where the medium is only English. And to break that barrier, we have said higher education can be offered in regional languages. But of course, we will leave it to the states, because you are aware that education is a subject in the concurrent list. And therefore, the government of India cannot impose upon the state governments such directions. But if any state government wishes to offer undergraduate programs and higher education programs in other languages, so for equity, we have said offering in other regional languages, making language teachers and language textbooks available in higher education for different languages. These would be efforts to maximize the participation of the socially and economically disadvantaged groups into higher education, thereby achieving the target of reaching a gross enrollment ratio, which is currently in 2018-2019 All India Survey Higher Education at 26.3, to reach 50% by 2035, which means we are almost doubling the GER from the current state. From the current state, if you want to double the GER, there are only two ways to do that. One, of course, is to provide for in different languages. Second is to maximize open and distance learning. And therefore, we have envisaged the ODL system as contributing to the enhancement of the gross enrollment ratio by offering more academic programs in different regional languages and making them available to students across the length and breadth of the country, and also offering teacher education programs and vocational education courses. So already universities like IGNO, and Kerala has recently started a state open university, and the other 13 open universities which are already existing in different states are offering their open and distance learning programs in different regional languages. And with the NEP actually giving a boost to ODL enrollment, you will see a massive enhancement in the enrollment to the academic programs of the open universities. And all the more so if they are being offered in regional languages, if they are being offered as per the felt needs of that particular region, and if they are being offered to address teacher education needs as well as vocational education needs. So the changes in the ODL system also envisage that we will see accreditation of ODL systems, because today you have conventional systems also offering distance education programs, but the quality of those programs remain a matter of debate, suspect, because you are actually not offering it through using ICT technologies. You are only giving some printed materials, and it becomes merely a degree machine rather than actually providing for quality higher education. So the ODL system, there is scope for expansion, scope for strengthening it, scope for deepening its academic programs, but at the same time, quality assurance would be a major aspect that the NEP has been focusing on. Coming to the other aspect of students, I would like to say that we have talked about optimal learning environments, because we want them to have not just the counseling for academic purposes, but also the psychological counseling, because today's students face a lot of stress. Now, in the COVID pandemic itself, where we are all doing things online, and where many of you have your children having online classes and things like that, while technology has been accelerated because of the pandemic, it is important that the isolation that the students feel and the psychological stress that the students face because of not having the direct face-to-face learning has to be combated. And even where direct face-to-face is taking place, the kind of isolation that has happened because of mobile penetration and the use of social media, where people feel that because you have 100 Facebook friends, you have a lot of 100 friends. No, they're not there. And therefore, the psychological isolation has led to a number of student suicides, One, because of the peer pressure to perform, parental pressure to perform, socially being felt as not being a performer at all, as being a failure. Therefore, in these student environments, we would like to see a lot of counseling happening so that they are physically fit, mentally fit, and academically supported, not just through academic counseling, but also through financial support. And that's why the whole idea of scholarships. Now, coming to teachers and the teacher education, the BEd program will be from 2030, a four-year integrated program, which is integrated, meaning it will be a BSc BEd or a BA BEd, and they will take place only in multidisciplinary environments. In fact, when I talked about the multidisciplinary higher education, I must mention that as far as the policy is concerned, we are going to have a situation where all higher education institutions, including the IITs, including the NITs, the IITs, all of them, they will all become multidisciplinary institutions. And we have also very clearly said that today, while we are very proud of having the largest higher education system in the world, we call our universities and institutes by different terminologies. We say they're central universities, state universities, private, affiliating universities, unitary universities, deemed universities. And all these nomenclatures would go, except of course for open universities, which would remain as open universities, but that all other nomenclatures would be frozen to say they are all either HEIs or only universities, and all of them would be treated by the same rules and regulations. You would have same set of norms and standards uniformly applying to all, which means even for offering scholarships, whether you're a private institution also, you would have to offer scholarships, because only then the aspects of equity and inclusion can be taken care of. It is equally important that when you say public and private would be treated on par, that the same regulatory norms and the same accreditation norms will be imposed equally for both public funded institutions and for private funded institutions. Now, on teacher education, the point that I was mentioning is that we would see a sea change, because we are talking about the national curriculum framework for teacher education being brought out, and which will also have national professional standards for teachers. Therefore, higher education has been, we have for the first time said that teacher education as a discipline is anchored in higher education. This must be recognized, and even open universities, as I said earlier, will be allowed to offer teacher education programs. But the quality of teacher education is going to be of a very high order. And because we are talking that from 2030, the only qualification or the only kind of teaching qualification would be BEd, that also four-year program, the qualification even for teaching at an early childhood care education across all levels will be BEd. Why we did that is because we are saying that a teacher who starts teaching a three-year-old in early childhood care education can go on to become a primary school teacher, because we have used a different nomenclature. We have said 5+3+3+4, foundational stage, preparatory stage, middle stage, and secondary stage. For all these four stages, we will have BEd as being the qualification, and a teacher who joins teaching at the preparatory stage can go on to become even a teacher at a secondary stage, because the qualification for becoming a teacher from 2030 would remain BEd, irrespective of the level at which you are teaching. And therefore, the career progression would be possible for teachers to move from early child care education even up to secondary stage education. And they can also take on academic leadership positions of becoming principals of secondary schools or principals of school complexes, as we have called. Now, coming back to the higher education and the faculty of higher education, we have said that we will recognize the importance of teaching as a profession. The autonomy of a faculty to innovate in the classroom situation, and that would mean both for teaching learning and for assessment. And assessment will move away from memory-based testing to application-based testing and critical thinking and promoting scientific temper, and will also have the freedom to innovate on the kind of pedagogical tools for effective teaching learning environments. Currently, higher education faculty are not held accountable for the learning outcomes of the students. But from now on, as far as the NEP is concerned, we would like a greater accountability of faculty in higher education, where they would also be responsible for the learning outcomes of the students And more importantly, to be able to say that if I do a course in sociology, what are the job opportunities that that particular course fetches for me? Therefore, the employability aspect being linked to the education part and the disconnect that is currently there, or the irrelevance of higher education and the employment market, is sought to be bridged. At the same time, we want to encourage innovation through promoting entrepreneurial education so that people can set up their own startups and come out with innovative ideas which would be able to improve the quality of life. And it is in this idea that we are talking about setting up innovation clusters, we are talking about setting up innovation cluster resource centers or innovation centers and centers of excellence, as well as a setting up of a new body called the National Research Foundation, which will inculcate a spirit of culture as well as a spirit of innovation in our young students and scholars, as well as in our institutions. So the NRF is also going to be a game changer and will have a lot of ramifications for the undergraduate and the postgraduate education. It will bring about the industry, the higher education institution, and the research labs coming together to generate a culture of greater research contributions with more patents, so that India could also be a bigger contributor to the research indicators that are there in the world. Ultimately, we are living in a soft power economy, and knowledge is the most important marketable commodity. And for knowledge to be marketable, you need to contribute to the research, both in terms of patents and publications, as well as not just be, you see, ultimately higher education is not just for job seekers, it is also for job creators. That's what teaching and research are. Teaching is knowledge assimilation, and from knowledge assimilation, trying to go for jobs. And that's why we have talked about teaching intensive universities. The other is knowledge generation and knowledge creation, which is through research and innovation and incubation and new patents and more areas of new products coming into existence to improve the quality of life. And therefore, the research intensive universities. And all this is possible only if you promote innovation and entrepreneurship. So overall, and I just end in the last with this exposure to technology, and it is not an exhaustive coverage of the NEP, that's not possible. I'd only like to talk about online learning and technology in education. We all have accepted that technology is important to improve the quality of teaching learning, to make it cost effective, and to make it accessible. The three triads of technology or ICT in education is for cost, quality, and access. So it is offering education at quantitatively larger numbers of a high quality because of the use of technology and in a cost-effective manner. And that is the democratization of education that institutions like IGNU and Open Universities seek to project and promote. And the idea of taking technology for administration and therefore better at transparent administration is equally important, as well as for data management. And therefore, in technology, we have talked about setting up a National Education Technology Forum, which will determine the kind of appropriate technologies for different academic programs rather than one size fits all, which is actually a disaster for a resource-crunched economy like ours. And therefore, applicability of the appropriate technology for different programs has been highlighted. But more importantly, since the pandemic came into existence in almost in February, and we are still writing the policy, we wrote a chapter, chapter 24, on online learning and digital learning, because we have recognized that it is important to look at the digital divide and the limited access to digital technologies and digital devices. In a country like India, this is a huge reality. And how do we take forward online learning without just where you cannot have internet and bandwidth penetration to the extent that you have in urban areas? You need to depend upon mass media, you need to depend upon printed material, the radio, the television, the satellite, direct to home channels. So we have Swayam, Swayam Prabha, these all will get maximized, as well as the important part of digital learning is that, are we prepared for this kind of digital revolution? Are we prepared, meaning are students prepared, are parents prepared, are teachers prepared, and are educational institutions prepared? So we have addressed this in our chapter by trying to say that we should have advocacy for the parents to accept the reality of online learning as it seems to go forward. Make the students understand how to use these technologies, and if they don't have access, the governments need to pitch in to provide these devices. The teacher training becomes very important so that they use online learning in the most effective manner. And ultimately, the educational institutions have to be prepared too, so that we can not just do the online teaching, but also conduct online examinations, ensure a very effective method of grievance redressal through an online mechanism. Otherwise, as I said, the stress that will be there, not only for the students, but also for the teachers and the administrators, would be rendering the idea of digital learning almost becoming a failure. So we have in the policy touched upon all these aspects with an idea of empowering the learners, recognizing the significance and the critical importance of the teacher in driving this set of reforms that are going to change the landscape of the way education would be transacted in the coming decades. And finally, make our higher education institutions very autonomous institutions where they can contribute to not just the knowledge assimilation and transmission, but also the knowledge generation, and become effective higher education institutions where we can make our students meet with the global challenges. I think I have taken it up to 3:30. I would only like to end by saying that open university systems are most flexible by nature, and they have done that quite some time back. It has been a journey where they have seen them having flexibility in duration, in the completion time, in the mediums of instruction, in the mode of which the learning is taking place. Counseling was already there. Student support services were already there. Now the new policy has more or less accepted and recognized that ODL seems to be the way forward. Technology-mediated learning is the way forward, but there should have adequate student support and proper sort of efforts to actually maximize individual potentials. And that is what the NEP 2020 has done. I wish the Innovation Club at RC Cochin all the very best in its future endeavors. And if there are any questions related to NEP, I'd be willing to answer them. If not, I think you could excuse me from being present at a session, which you can then go on to your handling the routine grievances and other queries that students may have, which the regional director and her team of people may be better competent to answer. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am, for giving us a very brief, I think, a bird's eye view of the NEP policy, I must say. And the way you have explained it in such a simple language, I think we all got an idea about what the basic pillars of NEP policy to 2020 are. Just I would like to highlight few aspects which you have just mentioned here. That is, you explained about the four pillars of education, that is learning to know, learning to do, learning to live together, and learning to live with others. And how it's more like a, what I understood from what you explained this, madam, it's more like an a la carte mode now, which is going to come in future, I think so, ma'am. Like, we have an option to select our Dish TV channels. Similarly, for a student who takes a admission in undergraduate programs, he would have an option to select his type of courses and his interest according to his or her interest. So this was an approach which, when I was studying in undergraduation, I always used to wonder why this option was not available at that point of time. So I'm happy that, ma'am, through this new education policy, this option would be made available to the students. And this, I'm sure, would do wonders to the undergraduate learners. And since you have already mentioned that we are moving to a more multidisciplinary mode, and that actually is very much required as far as our present employment scenario is also concerned, because we are not now restricted to a specific discipline, and that multidisciplinary approach needs to be followed if we have to move ahead. And very nicely you explained that aspect, I must say, madam. And you also explained about the flexible modes of education, and you also emphasized about the gross enrollment ratio, wherein you have even mentioned that to reach 50% of the GER by 2035, we need to have only two ways. That is what I suppose you had mentioned. One is maybe you have to emphasize on regional languages, and we have to maximize the ODL contribution, ODL system contribution. So that two ways which you have explained is really, I must say, that's a very, I think it will go a long way in enhancing the GER and making India a developed nation in future as well. Because I understand if the gross enrollment ratio increases only, we can
Ma'am, your audio is not clear, ma'am.
Ask the resource person in case. I just hello. I briefly lost my connection, and it seems, ma'am.
Yeah, please.
Sorry, ma'am. So in case, I leave the forum open as of now. In case anyone has any questions to our resource person, may kindly ask. Our academics are also there, Dorothy madam and other learners. If they want to interact with the resource person, we may just interact on the issues we are just she has just talked about. So Jalja ma'am, Dorothy ma'am, any learners who would just like to ask question to our resource person is most welcome to do so. Jalja ma'am?
Yes. Yes,
Dorothy ma'am. Yeah, in case you want to interact with the resource person, ma'am.
Dorothy ma'am was starting to ask, no?
No, ma'am. I am waiting, ma'am. If you all talk, then we can.
No, ma'am. You can
consolidate. That's what.
Yes, ma'am. Dorothy ma'am, please. Sir.
Friends, if any one of you have questions, then we can ask, because madam has to go.
That's why I
am waiting. Jalja ma'am, please, ma'am.
Shakila ma'am, actually we have heard a lot about you, but this is the first time I have an opportunity to hear you. I knew that you are also one faculty, or you are an expert in education, specialization of education, because you have your PhD in education. I didn't know actually. By hearing that, I'm so happy, because I am also from education discipline. But the thing I was asking, that you are mentioning almost all stages of education, means from elementary to higher education up to teacher education. You are mentioning about all the prospects we are planning in the new education policy. But ma'am, can you please tell something regarding open distance learning? Is there anything specially mentioned in the new education policy on open and distance learning, ma'am?
Yes, Jalja. In fact, the open and distance learning stands to gain a lot, because both in school education, the importance of the National Institutes of Open Schooling and the state open schooling systems have been highlighted for not only improving the making the access to education being made available, but also to talk in terms of innovative pedagogies while using it for skill development courses. I'm talking about the open schooling system first, and so also in terms of trying to have innovative assessment mechanisms, because when we are moving away from rote learning to let us say promoting scientific temper and cognitive learning and critical thinking, the kind of assessment formats that we currently follow are to be modified, and we are expecting open schooling systems to actually bring about those kind of reforms that need to take place in assessment and therefore in the examination system. Similarly, in higher education, the policy, though in terms of the actual physical attributes that we may have written only two paragraphs on ODL. But the running theme, if you will understand, in the aspect of enhancing the GER, which I think Prasita had mentioned also, when we are saying currently we are 26.3 and you want to reach by 2035 50%, we are not going to invest in brick and mortar setting up new universities. We have not wanted to promote that idea at all. Rather, we would like to leverage the open and distance learning systems. It could be through open universities, it could be the conventional universities offering distance education programs, or it could be pure MOOCs. Now, MOOCs are also a form of open and distance learning. It is a, let us say, a stage higher or at a much higher level than maybe an open and distance learning, because it is completely open. It is a completely what we call a massive open online course. And it could be offered through different platforms. Right now, of course, we are only having Swayam. It could also be through Swayam Prabha, which are direct to home channels. So IGNU has its own Gyan Darshan and its other channels, which are being beamed through satellites. So the policy has recognized the importance of open and distance learning in terms of enhancing access, particularly for the aspect of equity in unreached areas, and to offer it in different languages. Now, open universities, not just IGNU, which is at the apex level, but state open universities, which are currently about 14 in number, and our encouragement that more states should set up open universities, will start offering it in regional languages. But more importantly, we have highlighted the fact that there is no distinction between face-to-face learning and open learning, because in our undergraduate four-year program, we have clearly said a student can acquire credits even from open and distance learning. And you are aware that when the COVID pandemic struck, UGC's rules and regulation, which was allowing at undergraduate level 20% of credits through open and distance learning or of online learning, has been enhanced to 40%. So already you are seeing a greater emphasis being given to open and distance learning. The second important aspect of ODL is that it is important that the employer and other institutions value the degrees and the diplomas being offered by the open and distance learning. Now, currently, what is happening is that there is a certain degree of lower status being accorded to courses being done through the ODL system. Why does that happen? It happens because it is not the 17 open universities alone which are offering the 15 odd open universities alone which are offering ODL courses. You have about 200 plus universities, which offer distance education programs. And these are offered in a very diluted manner, of often affecting the standards. And you will find that they are students who have not really assimilated any knowledge and have come out with a degree in their hand. Therefore, we have said quality assurance and accreditation of ODL systems will be done. And this is very, very critical, because you cannot exist without getting yourself accredited. And we have therefore said accrediting open and distance learning formats or open and distance learning institutions will be taken forward. And many have asked, why didn't we talk about a regulator? Please understand, for us in the NEP, the regulation itself was to break down the current independent regulators for different disciplines. If on one side you are promoting multidisciplinary education, and then you said discipline-specific regulators, it is contradictory. And therefore, when we talk about the regulatory architecture, we are talking about one common regulator for all forms of education. But there will be professional standard setting bodies which can lay down the academic standards. So where a particular discipline, whether it is being offered in a conventional system or through ODL, the kind of academic standards it have to maintain will be same for both. And that will be decided by a professional standard setting body. More importantly, the ODL has got a clear mandate to offer teacher education programs. And you have bodies like the NCT actually not encouraging that at all. We have tried to overcome that, as well as offer skill-based courses or vocational education courses. So the integration of vocational education within ODL system will see a massive expansion of enrollment coming in to open universities and ODL systems through skill-based courses. And I think recently, a number of state-open universities had their skill-based courses being approved by the existing regulator, that is the UGC. This will see a massive expansion because the NEP has clearly encouraged that.
Okay, ma'am, thank you very much.
Dorothy, madam?
Ma'am, I will consolidate, ma'am. Anybody yes. else? And I will thank madam also.
Yeah.
Anybody else want to say? AR sir, I can see AR sir, Vijay Raghavan sir. See, what we ask, it will help the learners to take that message home. Anybody else? Or else then I'll just consolidate and then I will thank madam also. Thank you, ma'am, as Prasita ma'am was sharing and madam Shakila ma'am was also sharing. It is more like going to be a student-based choice. In other words, the student has more option and there will be, when there is more option, there is going to be more heterogeneity. And as distance education, I mean, relevance for that heterogeneity in distance learners challenge for studying will be, already you are away from the institution, you are away from the peers, and also you are away from the teacher who wrote the material. So with this background, when you are going to have uniqueness for your own course and you are going to be responsible for the course which you are opting, then it is up to you to ensure that you are confident in that subject. And one side, the university is going to give you wide variety of policy which is going to be increase or enhance the credibility of the open and distance learning system through the NEP, as madam was sharing. The other side of it is the commitment of the learner to be more enhanced when it comes to the successful completion of the program, which has been accessed voluntarily by the learner. And I also, this is what I could get it for a take-home message for the learners. And I also thank Madam Shakila for being with us and accepting our invitation. And friends, actually, I also want to share within this platform that the MOOCs program under the leadership of the former regional director, Dr. M. Rajesh, currently regional director at RC Vadagara. And the three faculty under his team when he was here in Cochin between the period 2014 up to 2018, I should say, Dr. Sindhu P. Nair, who's currently deputy director, and Dr. Jalaja Kumari ma'am, who is currently assistant regional director, and Dr. Prasita Unnikrishnan, who is assistant director at RC Cochin. The four member team has they have launched one MOOCs program, certificate in environmental studies. Initially it was a non-credit program, as an awareness program. It has been it has been awarded as the best online program of IGNU in the recently held Foundation Day on 19th November 2020. So this is what Madam see, friends, actually I want to link certain information what Madam Shakila was telling for you to do after this session. One is, you please visit the SWAYAM portal. There are humpty number of programs, more of variety than the programs on offer at IGNU also. And the uniqueness is, each course is separate. In IGNU, we say it is equivalent. We say that minimum certain courses you have to take even for associateship. That restriction is not there in MOOCs. So even if you want to take one course, you can successfully complete. And it is not going to hamper any of your other commitments because it is only online submission. And you have to, if you want a certification, you have to pay the fee for the examination and write the examination at the venue which they say. So it is not going to hamper in any way. So you see, in IGNU, you have to pay the fees in the first instance. Whereas for the MOOCs, only at the time of appearing for the examination. So that is the take-home message, my friends. I feel because you are already in the open and distance learning system from Madam speech. And I also want to place on records our gratitude on behalf of all the learners here and also of Regional Center Cochin to Madam Shakila for giving, sparing her time to be with us and throw light on NEP in a very simple language, which we can always remember in the days to come. And when we are going to experience some part or the other, either as a recipient or as a contributor for this NEP at the field level. And we also are grateful to Madam as one of our, we can recall that Madam was one of our colleagues even at Cochin Regional Center. And we assure you, ma'am, that we try to, we recall also the founding fathers, starting from Professor Satyapalan, Dr. Vasudevan, Dr. Shanmugam, Dr. Sukumar sir, and Dr. K.S.T. Nair, Dr. Venugopal Reddy, Dr. Rajesh, Dr. Sindhu ma'am, and even Dr. Jalja ma'am have been already in charge here. So all have set a trend, I should say, which help us to move ahead in a very smooth manner. Sometimes I fear it is only auto gear which you have to move ahead. So we are grateful to you, ma'am, because we can sometimes, when we see the old files, we do see your signature and we are really proud that somebody is representing Cochin, is representing the UGC, representing the NEP. Whenever we see your photographs, your articles in wide variety of the reports. And we also specially thank ma'am for, even though we wanted to have it as a event, we could not hold it either before or after due to various other commitments. And as you said, Dr. Joseph is also retiring on 27th. So with this background, in the small crunch time you have given us, and we are really gratitude. And we wish that every effort of you will be blessed by the Almighty God. And one message which is which beyond the NEP title, what Madam told, the one point she told, that is, each one is created by God in a unique way. That I always strongly believe. Sometimes how much, even in our own home, how much of a scoldings the same parent give to our sibling, it doesn't affect. Whereas a part of that, for example, when my sister is getting scolding, I will feel bad that my parents are scolding like that. But in her eyes, I can't see any expression. So some are like wired like that. But still, when it comes to studying, it is personal effort. You cannot have any excuse by telling I'm a very hardcore person, so I can't put much effort, etc. That is what I would say, that we have to consider when we are telling. One side, we are acknowledging that God has given us unique qualities. We have God, in other words, God has also given us unique responsibilities. That message will be put to full force when we are experiencing the NEP. That is what I would say from both Madam's the observation and the comment. And we really thank you, ma'am. And as ma'am said, after ma'am leaves also, we will continue with the grievance redressal. Anybody else who wants to speak, this is the last opportunity. Or one of the students can also thank madam, and then we can just wind up. Because to see, this is one opportunity for you to volunteer yourself to say thank you to a resource person in a virtual meeting. Generally, when we hold even at regional center, see, none of you would be knowing madam, neither even when you come, we won't be knowing you. But still, the link was some resource person have been sharing with us. So as a gratitude on behalf of Regional Center Cochin, if one of the student just express yourself to be considerate, expressing your gratitude, it will be, she'll also remember and we will also remember that. That is what I want to say. So any student who wants to say thank you to madam, please. I can see 23 of us, and then Ashu, Divya, and all our students, Elizabeth, Latika, Suresh, Meera Kannan, anybody else, any one of you. So even if you say, I was listening, it was nice, then it will be nice. I mean, that is also is enough. You can just tell your name, Rashmi, Rizwana, Sajuj, Xavier. I'm just seeing the contacts and the people in the Shailaja, and then Srija, all the others are staff. Any one of you?
I think Dr. Dorothy Madam has made an effort to motivate the students to say their thanks. Yes. I assume that silence amounts to a kind of thanks.
Okay.
So I'll just take it that they've been listening to me as much as you all have listened to me.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, I bless
you
all. And thank you very much for giving me this opportunity.
With your
permission, I'd exit from the discussion and you can go ahead with your program. Thank you very much.
Hi, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
And my best wishes to Mr. K.K. Joseph also, who's retiring tomorrow.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, madam, for your compliments. I'm Joseph KK. Actually, I have not worked with you in Cochin before my coming. You had left Cochin. However, you have heard about things, and it is a proud moment for IGNO to be. You have been a part of national education policy, and even in the eve of my retirement, I could listen to your speech, and it is a necessity that whenever this digital revolution is taking place, new education policy is a must. And you explained in each chapter, and I could get some points from that. So I thank you, madam, on behalf of all.
Ma'am has already left, and Divya, Ramesh, and Meera Kannan. Actually, both of you spoke after madam spoke. That reminds me, friends, I just want to share certain things. See, you know, performance is within the time limit, but our decision for performance comes before the initiation of the performance. In other words, you know, even when I suppose you are inviting me to your home, if you have decided, if somebody has decided in your home not to meet me, how much ever I request, nobody is going to come out. Okay, it happens even in our home, isn't it? How much ever you invite somebody? No, I'm just sharing it. This is a take-home message for other 21 who are here also. For next time, gratitude. When we say, just to say thank you, it will be nice for them to remember. Okay, and what I want to share with as a take-home message besides that is the life skill education which need to have. One is persistence. Yes, in the pandemic, initially at least we will come once in a while to counseling session. Now that is also not possible. So, and that is also not insisted upon. We are conducting all the sessions on online counseling. So our persistence level is likely to come down. And then the next one is, I just consolidate the certain which are being documented in newspapers also. See, sometimes our housemaid won't come, and ultimately we end up that anger on our studies, and we will postpone our studies. Okay, with IGNO or what is a procrastinate, not writing the assignment response, and the next one will be our work pressure will be home. At least initially we can say, tell our boss we are traveling, we are coming to office. Now they are asking us to work from home, and then it looks like all 24 hours we are doing the office work and no time for housework and for our personal development. So all that makes us to understand that we have to ensure there is time management at our level. So this is my sleeping time. Never compromise on your sleeping time. Maybe it can be reduced, but it cannot be zero always. And it cannot be too late or too early. In either case, your biological system is going to be affected. And then you can get angry, it's your emotion, but not on, and you cannot show it in a physical aggressive way on any colleague. So that is also one more issue. So we have to be careful when pressures mount up. How you behave matters a lot when it comes to the learning process also. So when you are writing a letter, how it is being manifested. See, so you highlight on what is your problem and you target at the solution, then only it comes leads to the facilitation will be there for the solution of the problem. And friends, I also always share that is one this fisheries department which give you hands-on skill development programs, and that is also very cost effective, and it has relevance to the coastal region of the Kerala and relevance for its small scale industries later in life. So you can visit that website, and it is also one of our study centers. Even though those programs, because they are useful for the public, we highlight on it. As already I shared, MOOCs program, that is in Swayam portal, SWAYAM. If you visit that site, humpty number of programs, right from how to speak over the telephone up to research writing is there, I should say, when you are interested in communication. And similarly, small language writing for computers up to sophisticated artificial intelligence courses are also there. So you please be benefited of this. And I also encourage, please, whatever, wherever you are in the learning path with IGNU, you are supposed to be in touch with the institution, that is your students, the learner support center or the regional center, so that your academic transactions and evaluation process are not affected. That is what I would like to say at this juncture. To invite questions or if you have any problems, and always know phone is a problem, I should say, because we do not sometimes when before many a time I should say when we, yesterday also we were trying to get somebody on the line. They called us before we could get their contact number. The call got disconnected at their end. Then later they called and the student called and told that the battery drained. So all this problem happened, and always verbal communication cannot be recorded. So that is why we always insist that you should give it in a representation in writing. So email will be the best way to communicate with us. And when you're communicating with IGNU, please don't write multiple problems in one letter. Non-receipt of study material, separate letter. Where to submit assignment, separate letter. But all your contact details, and then when is the counseling session, another letter. Don't put all three, four together. Because now always you understand it is going to be in different sections who is going to respond. And collectively, one reply won't come. So you will be annoyed if you are writing your collective representation. And please be in touch with your learner support centers. And if you have any of your friends studying with IGNU, you should be in touch with them so that they will help you out to push ahead. And when it comes to prerequisites, now friends, actually you should have submitted your term and examination application form if you intend to write for December, which has been postponed to be held in February, the 21st onwards it's going to be held. So you have to plan your vacation that way, and you also have to be very vision when it comes to notifying what has to be done when it comes to handling your subject which you study with IGNU. So please take one day at a time. Do not worry about tomorrow. And always, as Shakila ma'am was telling, no, it is the divine plan which helps us to move ahead. So please trust in God, because victory comes from God. Ultimately, whether in life or in personal endeavors, or for that matter, thinking of what to buy and what to eat also. It all depends upon the blessing of the Lord. So over to you, friends. Anybody having any information to be clarified, we'll be happy to address it. Anybody else? I'm going to the...
Good evening.
Yes.
Good evening, ma'am.
Yes.
I don't know whether this is the right time to ask this. But I had sent many emails, and I used to call to our RC. regarding this reimbursement of the fees. Are you able to tell about it now? Because I am...
Reimbursement of fees for SC ST, ma'am, and you under scholarship scheme.
It's only for SC ST. Is there any option for any this for OEC?
No, ma'am. No, actually, no, okay. You should not be working. Only then even SC ST people are eligible. And the fund came only day before yesterday, and we have released the fund.
Okay, yeah, so
for SC people who have applied. The scholarship form has to be obtained from the Social Welfare Department and submit at Regional Center, Cochin. That is the thing. And there is no other way. Actually, no, see, if you are employed, the government says it is only 1,000 rupees per month. Salary also, you are not eligible. So according to me, I don't think we go into a job where people are paying less than 1,000 per month.
Okay. I am a housewife, but I just wanted to know if OEC people are eligible for this reimbursement.
No, ma'am, only SC, ST, ma'am, as of now by the policy of the Government of India.
Oh, okay. Yes, thank you, ma'am.
Yes,
thank
ma'am.
You. And actually, I don't know, I'm even excited to talk like this. Because I don't even speak up like this anywhere, but when you told that it's good when you speak or when you thank someone, I would like our IGNO itself, because I have been away from books around 10 years, and just now only within this I'm now doing psychology. I'm in the second year, I haven't written the exam and all, but even then, it's so much excitement for me that I'm learning again. So much thank you.
Yes, thanks, ma'am. Friends, actually, I just want to, from my personal interaction with the learners, whoever is coming back to study after a span of time, this message can be useful for any of your friends, your family or relatives. Take a small course. Small course in the sense, in IGNO sense, it is a certificate course. Suppose you are little more, you taste the success of a certificate course, and it will give you more motivation to pursue a bigger venture. And also, I want to encourage you, friends, even if you are taking one PG diploma or a degree or a postgraduate degree, you can still do one certificate course. The uniqueness of a certificate course, no, by the time the deadline goes itself, the session is over, but still you can do your course if you have the basic eligibility criteria fulfilled. In other words, if you are having 10 plus 2, that standard of that material will be only that much. So that you can, that much in the sense to get access to the content. The value is going to be same as per the UGC norm for any certificate course. And once you start to know, once you see something under your name successfully completed, that's all. It will really make you to jump, take risk to enroll for some other course. And I also personally appreciate Divya ma'am for coming and speaking to us, no, about our experience of coming back to regional to study after a gap. And if you are comfortable, no, ma'am, you can just take our email ID, and you can. We are also collecting learner experience for our newsletter, so you can write to us also. It is a digital newsletter, so it can be easily circulated. And all our past issues of newsletter are there in the IGNO website. So please, one space which you should always visit is IGNO website, regional center and headquarters. Suppose you are opening the internet to check your mail, see that one checklist should be there. Have checked my IGNO website, because no, the first home page itself is enough for you to be in touch with what you are studying, and that is enough for you to move ahead. That is what. And related to examinations, not so far taken, always you categorize your course materials or the courses of the program which you have enrolled into three categories. One is only the theory, only practical, another is only project. The project and practical, you cannot venture out without your theory base. And theory counseling is not compulsory in IGNO. So in other words, you can still study the material, and when you start reading the material, it will look like the teacher is talking to you. So far you have read this, about this, etc., etc., like that. How we speak, the material is also written as if it is like a spoken language, interactive mode. So you
while we read these books which are given to us, when we are silent and when we read, it's actually, as you said, we feel like someone is talking to you back.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So that is what. And there are self-check exercises in between. So those should not be skipped. Sometimes, our students, they come and say half page question you have written and answer is also half page. That's why you please read at least the question and the answer. It will help you to catch what material has been transacted so far. That is what we will say. And there are a humpty number of self-check exercises which run through a block and unit. And if you take time to read those questions and answer those questions and check the possible answers given at the end of the unit, many a time you will be able to do well in your assignment response. Mm-hmm. The assignment response carries weightage for a continuous assessment, and the term and examination, the previous question papers are also there in the website. So we encourage you, please go through the website thoroughly, download the old question papers, mark questions, and attempt first the theory, then you will be strong, then the practical. See now, friends, even for people generally know what distance learner, somebody was telling, I can't recall the occasion, this pandemic has helped the ODL learner a lot. We were wondering how. I asked them how. They said, ma'am, initially we used to struggle to come to study center, go to this class, that class. Now sitting at home. And nowadays, almost all bosses are also considerate, They want to retain the good workers and they don't mind allowing them to study. So nowadays, the practical is also going to be virtual. So if you have not finished your practical for MAPC at least, is going to be held next week onwards. So it's high time you to be in touch with your learner support center. And so once you see now, you need not travel out of your home to come to practical, struggle here for 4-5 hours. But of course, when you are attending a virtual meeting or virtual practical lab, you have to take care of your home and other commitments. So those things you have to regulate, and you have to find substitute to take care of your home, picking up children or then whatever it is, engaging children and the like. And term and examination, now is the time. Beyond December 15th, you cannot fill the form. So you fill the form. Sometimes, it's 150. We make, it's a big amount for a student. Yes, we understand it. But still, we encourage you to fill, because 2 months is too long for any confusion to be retained there in anyone's life. Sometimes, many a time when we see some particular information today, it will shake us so much. And we will forget about tomorrow, day after tomorrow, etc. And we will think as if today is going to be the last day. It's not going to be so. So what I encourage is, please fulfill all the prerequisites, submit your examination form, and rest on God to set right the things in your life. So that in February comes, at least you will recall those yesterdays and you will thank God that you have traveled so much and now today peacefully are writing your examination. So if you, any one of you, the 15 people who are here, almost 5 or 6 are our own colleagues. The rest of you, I encourage you, friends, if you have not filled your exam form, please do it. That's what I will say to you. Okay, and anybody else want to speak? And one of you should thank for today. Thanking is not for us a sentiment. No, it is more like we are training somebody virtually to say thank you. Just say what is your name, what is the program you are studying, and what did you gain today, and how you will move ahead. That's all. And then we will wind up because it's already 4:15. And if you are not having any questions, then we will just wind up. Ashwini ma'am is also there, Ashu ma'am is there, Elizabeth ma'am is there, Divya ma'am is there. Anybody else? And when you're scanning your assignment to upload for December session, that message also, please keep it. See, for example, you stand and you keep it either on a stool or a chair and you scan it. Always know we tend to kneel down next to a chair and scan it. No, it is the image will be shaky. So either you stand up, keep it on the table, okay, or no, you are sitting right and writing on a chair, okay, keep it on the chair. It should be below your hip level when you're scanning a document, especially with a camera, with your mobile phone. So that is one. And please upload it and don't upload a soft copy and also send hard copy. So we are also collecting hard copy and handing over to the study center. So if you are, we'll encourage you always, please submit it at the study center. You post it, keep the speed post tracking with you. So that, and nobody says no for any doc received at our end. So you don't worry about it. And after sending one hard copy of the assignment, don't wait for some time. I won't say yes, it will be anxious. It's like sending somebody during this pandemic situation out of a place to reach their home. Yes, but still we have to wait for the time gap till it reaches the evaluator and it comes back to the regional center and then we upload the marks. So you got to wait. Okay, anybody else has any questions? Shailaja ma'am, Swana ma'am has left the meeting. Okay, anybody else? Or I will request Divya ma'am to say conclude, or Elizabeth ma'am is trying to speak.
Yes, ma'am. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Please continue,
yeah,
ma'am.
Yeah, just I'll also go ahead with the thank you. But before that, I just want to ask you something. I have been trying to get the date sheet and it hasn't been uploaded. Has it been uploaded now, the date sheet for the exam?
No, ma'am, not yet uploaded, ma'am. And no? That makes me to remind you applying for the exam, the acknowledgement, we can check it after 24 hours. And okay. Both the photograph and also the date schedule is not there. It says it will be given later. Okay, and we do encounter in our help desk, we did encounter issues with associate students. So any of you are associate student, please check your registration details and also try to fill the exam form. And if you are getting stuck anywhere, please take a print screenshot and there is one email ID given with the error message itself. You send it within maybe 2-3 hours, they rectify it. Okay, so that is one. Okay. And it okay. is February 21st onwards, they are going to start. We are waiting to schedule it because, you know, we are expecting more students to come. And so okay. far, and people also say we may likely extend the date of filling the exam form also later, depending okay. upon the need. So we got to wait. Always, when it comes to checking the date sheet, I should say it's a valid advice also for you all. Please don't check it 1 month before because no, it's not going to be constant every time. Sometimes it do change. At least a day before or afternoon, depending upon the examiner's strength. So always it is better once the hall ticket is printed with the exam date, then you check it with the date sheet. But of course, that happens maybe 15 days before the examination. And as per norms of any service condition, 10 days is enough to apply for leave prior to the thing. And when you are writing, when you are working from home and writing examination, be honest enough to take leave. Because when you are going for your accreditation, that is means after certification, your things have to be uploaded in the records of your office. At that time, they will check whether you have availed leave at that period. So you have to be safe at that angle. That's why honesty always has spin-off benefits. please take your boss into confidence, and then but still if you are doing something without permission of your boss, it won't be recorded in the office records, which we are not aiming at, isn't it? So see, ultimately if you study, your office should for example MA psychology, if you are studying, after you complete it, your office should facilitate to put it behind your name in your visiting card, etc. Nobody studies just to gain knowledge, like indigenous knowledge. No, this for some career development, for some financial increment, etc. So you or sometimes for the well-being, that is different. Even then you should be proud to put the your qualification earned behind your name, for which records, official records, are very important. Is anybody else? And then we can wind up this.
Ma'am, I have one more thing. Mm. I wanted to ask you about ID card. See, I tried to print my ID card, and what I got, it's got the enrollment number and all the details, but it doesn't have a photo. So is that the actual ID card online? Because I registered online. Okay. It was online registration, so I'm supposed to print it online, right?
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. So, Prasita, so ma'am, can you just throw light on this, ma'am?
Prasita, ma'am, is on mute.
She will come back.
Okay.
Or yeah, because, ma'am?
It's got my name and all other details, but it doesn't have a photo. So is that good enough, or is there any way to get one with the photo?
No, that is what I just want to get it from the admission section, ma'am, because so far I have not encountered such issue. Or okay. What you do is, maybe there is some problem in unmuting their thing, because the system yesterday also it gave trouble. So what I will suggest is, you take our email ID, madam is back.
Okay.
I think many of you have your speaker on. You can put a print screen and you can send it also. Now,
ma'am, I didn't listen to her because I got disconnected, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Prasita, ma'am, her problem is our ID card do not have the photograph in there.
Okay.
It is downloaded. Is it by error from our side, or
we'll have to check. Can you please write an email to prasita@igno.ac.in with the enclosed screenshot of that ID card? I'll just check and get back to you. Okay.
Prasita@igno.ac.in.
Or you can also put in a mail at rckochin@igno.ac.in. Okay.
Okay, I'll do that. Yeah.
And both these email IDs, you can put your mail. We'll just check it and get back to you. We'll need to check about it. Normally,
it is there. And if you are putting, some of us have put very small photograph, all that, it is not coming.
Okay. So this was according to the specifications, they had said that it has to be a certain size.
Generally, photograph should come, ma'am. So we have to try. That's why I also told you.
Check. Okay.
We'll check and get back to you.
That sounds good. Okay.
And write your enrollment number, your phone number, so that if you want to get back to you, we will get it.
Okay. Right. Okay, fine. Now I've submitted my assignments. Now, in order to see whether it is back after checking.
No, I told you, you have to wait till the exam results come out. Okay. Once you submit it for 6 months, you can happily keep quiet.
Okay. Just wanted to see if it will be available before the exam.
My entire presentation I was highlighting about waiting period. Yes.
Okay, fine. No problem.
Anybody else?
I can go ahead with thank you.
Yes, and one more, friends. Actually, after this session, maybe I think around 5:30 or so, we are having one Facebook session about IGNU programs. Dr. Vijay Raghavan will be with us. Please join in and encourage people who are interested in studies or just want to get. They are listening to you. You are motivating them, and they want one more push from somebody else. Then you should introduce those people to our Facebook sessions.
Okay. What's the timing for that, ma'am?
5:30, ma'am.
5:30.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, ma'am. Anybody else? Or else we'll wind because it's already 4:20.
Okay.
So can I request Elizabeth ma'am and Divya ma'am also, I think she's on the line or she left, I don't know, both of you to say a few words about today's session and then we will call it a day to wind up.
Yes, my name is Elizabeth Susan and I'm doing the PGDEMA course and I'm happy to have attended this session. This session actually gave a pretty good insight into the new education policy. So it was, and madam explained it really well, like everybody mentioned in simple language. It's a lot to cover, but still she managed it well, and it was really appreciated. In fact, when ma'am said to go ahead and thank, and I was about to hit enter, and at that time ma'am already started speaking and she said bye. But anyway, I missed out on that opportunity. But at the same time, it was really a wonderful session that really gave us a pretty good idea about the new education policy, which actually is multidimensional and it will be beneficial for each and every one of us for future purposes as well. And I thank R.C. Cochin and our Dorothy ma'am and Prasida ma'am and Jalaja ma'am and the rest of the team and all of you for conducting such sessions, which is beneficial for each one of us students. To get clearance about our queries as well as with this innovative platform to get more sessions like this. We expect to get more sessions like this so that we can also gain from that as well. So thank you very much, ma'am and your team for conducting such a session. And I also thank all the attendees who took the time to attend as well. Thank you.
Thank you, friends. Anybody else want to share? Or can we wind up? Or we'll say bye and we will meet next month also. Okay. And if Prasida ma'am has to have something, or Jalaja ma'am has to say something, over to Jalaja ma'am or Prasida ma'am.
No, then we will wind up. Thanks, Uli.
Just I wanted to say today that today K.K. Joseph sir, for him, I think this would be last Innovation Club session, which is officially attending as an assistant registrar. So I would request K.K. Joseph sir, are you there? K.K. Joseph sir, are you there? No, I think he has left the meeting. Okay.
Yeah, he's not showing on the list, ma'am. He's gone.
Okay, ma'am. So, maybe Dorothy madam, we can wind up the session then, ma'am. Okay,
thanks.
If you want Joseph sir to be connected, I can connect, ma'am, because he's in the next cabin only. I'll just connect him.
Okay, ma'am. Better now.
Ma'am, sir has gone to the bank, it seems, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am. So maybe, ma'am, we can just wind up the session.
Yes, ma'am.
So thank you all for attending this session and making this a very interesting and enriching session for all of us. I once again thanks our Regional Director, Dorothy madam, for permitting us to organize this session and giving her vital inputs and interactions. And my colleagues, Dr. Jalaja Kumari and Dr. Vijay Raghavan, who all attended this session. And to all my dear learners who also interacted and attentively attended this session. So thank you all. You may all now leave this. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Thank you, ma'am.